Hey guys, Jake Carlson here, host of the Modern Leadership Podcast. Are you ready to focus on amplifying your leadership superpowers? Let's go. Good morning, my friends and fellow elite achievers. Welcome to Modern Leadership, the podcast where each week we sit down with authors, entrepreneurs, and leaders to explore their journey, diving into the ups, their downs, and ultimately the lessons they learned along the way. Our goal, of course, to show that everything is figure outable. Today's guest expert is Eddie Yoon. Eddie is the founder of EddieWouldGrow, a think tank and advisory firm on growth strategy. He is the author of the book Superconsumers, a simple, speedy, and sustainable path to superior growth, published by the Harvard Business Review, which was named one of the top business books of 2017 by Strategy Plus Business. He has written over 100 articles in HBR. He has appeared on CNBC, MSNBC, and has given keynote talks around the world. And today he is our guest. Eddie, a mouthful. Welcome to the podcast. How are you today?
I'm great, Jake. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, absolutely. And before we jump into this, give us a little bit more background. We know about your business life, but how about your personal life?
Sure. So I was born in Hawaii, child of immigrant parents from Korea. So they moved right before I was born. And I ended up in Chicago for college, not having ever been to the Midwest. But I figured, simplest way to make decide for college is where did I get the most financial aid and, you know, where was the best school I could get into?
Right.
So I ended up in Chicago. I got my job there in consulting because I had no idea what I wanted to do. And met my wife, who is from Chicago. So here we are. And for the long haul, it looks like.
I bet you that was quite a, not just weather shock, but culture shock to go from Hawaii, the islands, the heat, the warmth, the aloha to Chicago, the hustle bustle, the cold, the city.
Virtually every facet of every part of my life, as you said, was completely shocked, as it were. And it probably mirrors the, analogous to the shock that you go through having kids. So, my wife and I, we have three kids. We have a two junior high schoolers and a high schooler. And, I would say, I can't decide, moving from Hawaii to Chicago, which one is the bigger shock, or becoming a parent? Probably the latter.
How about having a teenager?
Oh, yeah, that's been a humbling experience, let me tell you that. So I just soak it up all from anyone who's a little bit ahead of the journey so I can learn from them. So.
Well, great. We have a ton to talk about. And the first place I want to start is actually how you got on this podcast. And this refers or relates to one of your kids, Audrey. And you got to tell this story about how you set up your marketing to break through all the crowd. Because I'll be honest with you, Eddie, I get about 10 requests a week to be guests on the podcast. And currently I'm 100% saying no to all of them just because, my list is so long right now. So tell us the story about how you broke through in this story with your daughter.
Sure. So my middle daughter, Audrey, when she was in sixth grade, this was 2 years ago, she had a writing assignment that was, let's write a book. And so she ended up writing an assignment, and she's our most private of our three children. So says very little, kind of still waters run deep type of a person. And, so we had no idea what she was doing. And her teacher emails my wife and I and says, hey, Audrey wrote something. I think it's quite notable. You ought to look into publishing it. And so we ask her for the copy. And lo and behold, it's not quite what you would think about as a book assignment, because it read more like a screenplay, if I were to describe it, because it was probably two-thirds describing the visual context and the feel of what it was, and less one-third the actual content of the book. But the narrative that she wrote was about a yellow balloon that relentlessly pursues a man who is a workaholic and kind of forces him to confront his addiction to work before he loses his family. And I'm reading this, and my first reaction was like, are you writing about me?
Yeah, who's the man in this story?
who could the man possibly be? And, you know, of course, she claims no. And, you know, I don't think we'll actually know the truth until maybe 20 years later and several thousand dollars of counseling later and the like. But we'll see. But, you know, and then the second question, as I showed it to some people, they were like, you know, they would always ask questions, she's writing about you. And then they would say, is she writing about me? And I think what I realized was that it was something that seemed to kind of put people on edge, which I actually thought was interesting. Any kind of working parent is going to confront this issue. And so it kind of snowballed. I sent it to a publisher for a children's book company that I knew, and he had the same reaction. So it started out as a book that we wanted to do just for, you know, family and friends. And then it kind of snowballed, and she chose an illustrator. Long story short, it came out on Amazon in July this past year, on 2019. And as part of that, I've been kind of on this journey of like, I'm not quite sure what to do with the book, other than I'm trying to encourage my daughter. And, you know, she's mortified that it's even gotten this far because she's very private, as I said. But, you know, I just figured, there's something about this that might be relevant. And because I had written a book and gone through the whole, you know, lecture circuit and podcasting and TV and whatnot, I was like, you know what, I'm going to try to reach out to some friends. And so Tom Schwab, Ballet, who I used beforehand to promote my HBR book, he had the idea of the yellow balloon and the book. And because he had the same reaction, and he was like, we have to do something kind of visual and arresting, just like the book is, because we think the message is important, regardless of, you know, what it is as a book. I think the narrative of, can you stop and take a few steps back and kind of decide, am I a workaholic, and what is it costing me, and can I confront this before someone confronts me?
So here I am, and I get a box come to my front door, and it's, you know, about 12 inches tall, about 18 inches long. And I open this up, and guess what's inside? A copy of the book, Joy, written by Eddie's daughter, and this yellow balloon, like filled up, pumped up balloon inside this box. And so obviously I have to figure out what's going on. I look through the materials in there. I see the one sheet that, you know, Tom and his team sent over, and I immediately had to get you on the show.
Yeah, well, kudos to Tom for bringing it to life and the Interview Valet team. And, you know, that I think that was such a brilliant idea that they had with it. And I'm glad it worked. I mean, you know, to your point, there's something about something tactile, as you said, like you kind of in this day and age, you need kind of a multimedia version way of kind of gripping your shoulders and kind of shaking you out of a stupor if you're in one and stuff. So I'm glad it's working.
I picked it up. I read it when we first got it. And as I was preparing for this interview, I had to go search around my house to find this book. I couldn't find it. And there it was under my son's bed. He's 8 years old. He had found it and claimed it as his own. But I now have it sitting on my desk here. And it really is a beautiful story. And Eddie, just so you know, this podcast originally was called the Family Before Fortune podcast, building the life of your dreams with the people you love. And so this really resonated. But here we are, fast forward to today. We got you on the podcast. You're the author of Super Consumers. You do a lot of speaking around the world on a lot of these topics. And so we got to pick your brain on what's going on. So tell us a little bit about Super Consumers.
Sure. So it is funny, Jake, how you mentioned about family before fortune. Because if I really go back to the true origin story for the Super Consumer book, which ties to Audrey's book, it goes back to probably, I want to say, 12, 13 years ago. My wife and I, we had two kids at the time, and we were arguing whether or not we should have a third. And she had three kids. She grew up as one of three. I grew up with one of two. And we're like, hey, why roll the dice? We're kind of happy with the two that we have. And at the time, career-wise, I was at the Cambridge Group. My career was going well. I was up for partner and had kind of cleared all the hurdles to get there. So it was really a decision of, did I want to do it or not? And our arguments kind of got into a, is it one or the other? You know, should we have a third child, or should I pursue, you know, this career milestone and become a partner in a consulting firm? And, you know, so we kind of really struggled with this for a while until we kind of took a step back and each kind of gave each other a little bit of grace. But what the insight that we got to was, you know, there's probably a both and solution. So if we came at it from what would need to be true for us to have, you know, grow our family, but also not compromise on my career, because, you know, that would kind of crush my soul a little bit. And that took me a lot of effort to admit that. That what we got to was that, you know, if I really wanted to have a both and without it compromising my role as a father and a husband, then I really needed to not just be a partner in name, but a real like thought leader in the marketplace. And, you know, somewhere where it wasn't just my title that kind of got people to come find me, but the quality of the ideas and the value and the impact that I had. And so that began my journey of business writing. So I was doing a lot of consulting. Then I started writing for the Harvard Business Review, and a lot of serendipity happened for that. And, you know, I hadn't really set out to write a book, but eventually you keep writing about your experiences, you get traction, you get better at it. And then HBR said, hey, would you like to turn some of these ideas into a book? And thankfully by then I had written enough so that, you know, maybe like a fifth of it had already been like written, because I had content that I could repurpose with it.
It gives you a little bit of a template, a starting spot.
Totally. And so, yeah, it was really quite a far more enjoyable experience, because I was quite daunted about writing a book, in the sense that, you know, I think Salman Rushdie, the famous author of the Satanic Verses, who had a bounty put on his head after writing that, like, you know, he says, like, don't write books, which, you know, he can tell that story. He was like, everything's been ever written. You're going to submit yourself to criticism, which can go very badly. There's no upside to it. And he said, the only reason why you should write a book is if you can't sleep at night because you have a message to get out. And that was kind of my situation, was that after, you know, doing growth strategy for some of the world's largest consumer facing companies, what I realized was it's a lot simpler than, you know, kind of classical consultants make it, because, you know, it's in kind of a consultant's best interest to make things feel really complicated so that you have to hire them for their services and whatnot. But
yeah, that's true.
Yeah. So, yeah, it was a lot of it. It was just a collection of, these are the foundational principles that I've learned, that in a world where, you know, a GPS, you may not have it, or it may actually lead you to drive into a lake, that maybe having a compass might actually work better. In a world of complexity, this idea of super consumers being a very simple way of thinking about consumers who are high passion and high profit are also the most proactive, and they're the most insightful to help you figure out how to grow your business. And frankly, if you just knew that North Star, then you might be able to make every business decision faster and better than if you just took, you know, 3 months out to do a whole bunch of analysis on it. So that was kind of the motivation and the thesis of the book as well.
Yeah, and I'm a big believer in action. Even imperfect action at least gets you moving. You talk about, we could do analysis for 3 months and still make a mistake. And what have we lost? We've lost 3 months. But if we just create action now, we can always adjust, pivot, and change. I wanted to ask you a little bit about super consumers and the power that they hold in growing our businesses, particularly today, in where technology and we're all interconnected more often through social media, the importance of creating this tribe of super consumers for growing your business.
Yeah, you know, great question, Jake. So the part that I always say, and this is kind of not just my own consulting experience, but my old firm was acquired by Nielsen. And so I had access to a ton of data, which was super helpful from a research perspective. And one of the things that I found was that, and this is true over my career, is that most companies, the vast majority of them, when you look at their growth strategy, it is, how can I take market share from my competitors? So let's say, Jake, you and I are both in the, you know, the shampoo business, and 9 out of 10 companies, the way that they're going to grow is to, I'm going to take market share from Jake, and then you'll take it from me. And then we both end up
in a tug of war.
Exactly. And it's kind of a, where we both end up falling down and everybody loses, especially to the consumer, because what I end up doing is I copy your product, then you discount mine, and then nothing really happens in a better way. And so what the research has shown is that companies that are actually able to grow the category, that what's interesting is that if I can get more people to use more shampoo and pay a higher price for it, then not only does everybody win, but the company that actually has that strategy, that 1% of those companies capture 80% of the category growth. And so it is one of these rare situations or counterintuitive where if I kind of focus on lifting the tides of all boats, my boat actually gets the furthest and the farthest. And it kind of goes back to this notion of the way that you grow a category. It's pretty simple, actually. It's kind of three different variables. Can I get more people into the category, more consumers? Can I increase the units per consumer, or can I increase the price per unit? And the reason why super consumers are so important is that they are, if you think about the Dr. Seuss book, Green Eggs and Ham, they are the guy relentlessly pursuing everybody else. You got to try these green eggs and ham.
Yeah.
And other people are out there, no way. I won't eat them on a plane. I won't eat them on a train. And eventually, they wear people down. And because, in part, they are missionaries who have figured out that category X actually is not just about scratching this minor itch. It actually can make their life meaningfully better in a transformative way. And if you actually knew better how to use it, then you might come on board. And so they're the best ways to increase consumers. They're the best ways to say, oh, you know, have you thought about using it this way? And they're the best at saying, you know what, this brand versus that is actually worth its weight in gold. And so therefore paying a premium should not be scary to you. And that's my whole thing about the North Star and the Compass idea, is that they're the MacGyver consumers of the category. They have figured out the best way to use the category and the best things to buy within it. And they teach other people, which, by the way, has so much more credibility than anything. You know, I could buy 20 Super Bowl commercials as a company and shout it, and it would not have the credibility of somebody you know who is a guru in the XYZ category telling you, hey, my experience and my expertise says to do it this way.
So where's the starting point for us? So we have this belief, and I agree 100% with you. I'm looking at the categories, and I'm looking at the things that my businesses do, and I agree 100%. I say, Eddie's right. We got to grow the category. I can't just compete with other podcasters. I can't compete with other coaches. I can't compete, and so on down the road. Where do I start, though? Where do I identify my super consumers, and then how do I approach them to help me create this new category growth? Or is that the way that I do it?
Yeah, no, you're on the right track, Jake. And let's take podcasting as an example there. So the way that I would do it is, I bet you within your listeners, there are not just Jake Carlson super consumers, but there are podcast super consumers. And, you know, it the simple question of, you know, do you love podcasts? You know, many of your listeners will say yes. How many hours per day and how many podcasts do you have on your phone at any given time? And that simple question, I think what you want to do is identify the people on the most extreme. Now, most companies tend to ignore those folks, thinking that they're just aberrations and not useful because they're just weird people, right? But what you end up finding is that, how in the world is it that you can consume 2 to 3, you know, 30 to hour long podcasts a day? And then what you quickly get into is like, well, how are you using it? Well, I have a long commute. I use it there. Or I travel on a plane. I use it there. I work out, and that's when I do it. I have a ton of baseball games that I'm driving the kids to, and this is what I do to kind of keep me going with it. And so what you end up figuring out is, boy, these people, it's not just that they like it. It is something that makes the commute better. It reduces road rage. Or frankly, or it's something like, maybe I'm traveling a lot and therefore I have a lot of time to listen to a podcast, but I have a problem that I'm really trying to solve that I don't have enough expertise in. And this is my mini graduate school crash course way of doing it. And so what you end up figuring out is that there's a higher order need. I call them quests that super consumers have. And the reason, like, there's always a rational, emotional, and aspirational reason why they behave as extremely as they do. And that within that, what you end up finding is that, you know, someone who is not a podcast listener might not say, hey, you know, I don't have a commute, I don't have that problem. But he said, no. My goal is to, you know, I never went to grad school. I never took this class. I'm learning how to do something for the first time, and I'm scared to death. And this is my mini PhD that I can get in something that really matters to my career, matters to me as a parent, matters to me as a whatever, my marriage. And then that becomes like, well, you know, I might not be a podcast super, but if you ask the question, would you like your career to go better or be a better parent or be a better spouse? a lot more hands go up as a result of that, right? And so that's kind of the kind of transformative nature of a super is somebody who's figured out that a category can be so much more than what it seems, and they convince other people to come on board and join them in their behavior.
And they do it subconsciously, right? I mean, you're not talking about someone who consciously thinks about how to grow the category. You as the business owner do. I mean, that's your goal and your role as the leader. But what we're talking about here is consumers of your product, your service, or whatever your offering is, and they may not know that they're super consumers. They may just be passionate about it. They listen. As you were talking about this, I recognize that I am a super consumer of podcasts. I mean, as you went through it, do I listen on the train? Do I listen on the plane? Do I listen in the air? Do I listen when I don't care? Yes, I'm listening all the time. I'm 2Xing my podcast because there's just so much that I love. And I don't recognize maybe that I'm a super consumer in the fact that I consume a lot, but not as my role as a connector, as Malcolm Gladwell would talk about in Tipping Point, to get other people involved in it.
Yeah, that's such a great bridge to Gladwell's concept in the Tipping Point, because I think, Jake, what I love about it is that there's always these little tells, like, do you listen to your podcast on 1.5 or 2X? That's a tell, right? Like, and it's usually kind of the, whatchamacallit, it's the NFL ticket, right? It's the beauty of NFL ticket is not that you can watch a game quicker. It's that you can consume more games because you can watch them quicker as a result. What's really cool about it is that, to me, you just explained to me why you have a waiting list of 10X long to get on your request on your podcast, because you are yourself a podcast super consumer. It's a craft to you. Not only do you care about it, but it's a profession and a craft, almost like playing the piano or perfecting your batting swing. Like, it's just something that you do just for the innate beauty of it. And that the other part that I would ask you about, Jake, is that my data has shown that if you are a super consumer of one category, like you for podcasts, you end up being a super consumer of 9 other categories, some of which are obviously related and some of which are not. But I suspect that your headphones, earphones, your audio visual equipment, just by the nature of your podcast, but because you're a podcast super, probably you are pickier and buy more premium stuff or have more of it. That would be my guess. You tell me if that's true or not, though.
Yeah. So I've got, you know, the Beats headphones, which I absolutely love. I've got the MacBook Pro here with the wireless keyboard and all that, the big 32-inch screen hanging out in front of me. Yeah, I definitely am very picky about my equipment. I got to tell the listeners, I've got this standing desk that rises and lowers, not just a piece of the desk. The entire desk is on a motor and rises up so that I can always stand during my podcast. And I've got the best foot pad. It's got all these little bumps and balls on it so I can walk around, and people think I'm on a treadmill if they see me on video, but I love all of this stuff. You're absolutely right.
The ecosystem that you described is perfect, because you might not get someone into podcasts straight away, but if you have somebody who is who has got, you know, high quality earphones and Beats headphones, or they love a standing desk. What I love about those two things is that if you care about audio, you're probably going to care about podcasting, because it's, you know, it's not just information. I would submit a great podcast is like listening to music. There's something soothing about the person's voice. There's something energetic, like a duet when two people are connecting well, right? I mean, there's a musical quality to it. And so I think people can come into podcasts that way. And then the standing desk insight is a brilliant one. I have one. And what it tells me is that, hey, you're somebody who likes to kind of kill two birds with one stone. You want to get work done, and you want to, you know, avoid the sitting. You want to have some, you know, blood flowing or activity going on there. And podcasting is perfect for a multitasker, right? It's like somebody who wants to, you know, make the most of every minute that they have. And again, you might not have been hooked on the podcast in and of itself, but what you just described is exactly the super consumer theory of, I can bring you in through multiple doors into the same home. And by understanding that your super of one is a super of nine, and that to me is the most fun about the concept, is that it's all kind of born out of extensive research and data and my consulting experience. But I find that it's pretty intuitive and people get really excited once they kind of get going with it.
Well, this is the best light bulb moment of the episode so far for me, is this idea that, okay, Jake, you've identified one. What are the other nine? And so, Eddie, how do I go about, for me personally, identifying what those other nine are? Do I, you know, take a one day off and go walk on the beach? Or how do I figure out what those other nine are?
Yeah. So I'll give you a couple micro and a macro way of doing it. So the micro way of doing it is, I filled out your superpower test.
Assessment, yeah.
It's your assessment there. And so I have to believe that the people who've gone through it, right, are just more engaged. What you want to do is identify other podcast super consumers, either your listeners, your friends and family. Like I always say, there are people always around. Like I did this exercise with one of the world's largest pork producing companies, which is kind of funny to think about, but like they found that they had a bacon super consumer in accounts payable. And it was this guy, young guy, it probably consumed a pound or 2 pounds of bacon a week, which is kind of crazy to think about.
Not for very long, I imagine.
Well, that's kind of amazing. I don't know what the deal is with his metabolism, because he seemed pretty healthy to me. But anyway, he was a hidden asset, because he was the very best person to ask about new product innovation. And they would not have known, because he was not in the innovation group. He was a finance guy. So there's always super consumers all around you. And I always say, go look for them. And then I always say, you look at what Disney has done with Marvel. They've made billions of dollars telling origin stories of superheroes. And what I say is, find a super consumer in your life, your viewers or whatnot, and tell me the origin story of how did you become a super consumer? Because you weren't born a super consumer. You evolved that way. And there were triggers and steps along the way that kind of give you these clues for what the nine other categories might actually be. Right. And so, you know, like I'll tell you, like my wife is a crafting and sewing super consumer. And the trigger event, a couple trigger events that happened for that was the first house that we bought, where we actually had space for her to put the stuff in, having a baby. Because it was, as a woman who was working as an ICU nurse before and a nurse practitioner, it was just like, she loved being a mother, but it was like Groundhog's Day. I had no forward progress in my life, and it was just discouraging. So I needed to make something that I could feel good about, right? And then, that triggered a whole set of things that are, you know, they're interrelated, but they're not obviously directly there. And so I think that whole, that origin story is incredibly important. That's kind of number one. And then number two is, there are, for companies that have a good amount of data, one of the things that I always say is there's so much value in the data that you have, but you haven't looked at it perhaps in the way that you might think to, which is to say, I always say that there's kind of big data that's kind of thrown around a lot. And so you can look at data nationwide. You can look at one-to-one data. So, you know, Jake, if I'm one of your viewers, like you have maybe some information about me. I always say kind of the middle ground is the most important thing. So if you looked at podcast listeners by zip code and podcast per capita at the zip code level or a city level. One of the things that I have found that's quite interesting is a concept called super geographies, where birds of a feather flock together. My guess, Jake, is that if you looked at a map of your listeners, that you'd see pockets kind of clustered together. And those pockets are probably places where podcasts in general spike high. In that what you then want to look for is, well, that's kind of cool. What other things are the things that spike high in that local area that might be clues and cues? And so the example that I'll give is that I did some work for Mattel way back when on their Fisher-Price business. And, you know, so the question becomes, well, how do you grow the Fisher-Price brand? It's kind of toddler toys and in a world where, you know, digital and iPads are all kind of consuming and whatnot. And the thing that we found was when we looked at this local data, what was quite fascinating was we looked at what are the other things that correlate with a local market where Fisher-Price per capita spend is really, really high. And ironically, what we found was a couple of obvious things. So local areas that had basements make sense, right? You got to store all of that.
You got a place for all that stuff.
Exactly. And it was inversely correlated with weather. So in nice places, I think up by your neck of the woods and, you know, if the weather is great and you go outside.
You send them outside. get them on the swings in the pool.
So you had those things. But the thing that was actually really fascinating was book spending, which is kind of counterintuitive to toy spending, right? So the more that a household spent money on books, in particular children's books, the correlation to toddler toys was off the charts. And if you think about it, one of the interesting things about a toddler toy is not something that you buy and Junior can be left alone with, because Junior might put it in his mouth and choke and whatnot. It's an active parental engagement activity. And at that same age, so are books, right? Because books, you're physically there. You're reading the book to your child. You're holding the child. And that same willingness to be that engaged and spend time was 100% correlated with your willingness to buy toys. And that kind of flipped the whole paradigm on its head. Like, we thought of books as competitors, but it's actually a compliment. And so how do we think about how to activate that strategy was really quite interesting, because most companies want to attack their business on a national level because it's easy. Attacking it on a local level is actually far more effective. And if you're an entrepreneur, that actually works quite nicely in your favor too.
And I think that's the future of marketing. You know, we've gone from this, billboards and radio and television down to this more block and tackling one-on-one marketing, which tends to be more local, even if you define local being, within your social network, even if you're not geographically local. I think that's the future of marketing. Now, Eddie, I always say that I am the target audience for this podcast. And so the things that are of interest to me, I think are interesting to my listeners. And I look at our time and I can tell that today is a very interesting topic because our time is ticking by. I'm having so much fun. I could stay on for a couple hours, but alas, some of our listeners need to jump into work. So it's time now to shift to our learning from leaders section. Are you ready?
Sure. Let's go for it.
All right. Our first question then is the book currently on your Kindle or bedside table. What are you reading?
I am actually rereading a book called Doing What Matters. It's by Jim Kilts, who was the former CEO of Gillette and Kraft and is now at Centerview Partners. And, what I love about it, he's one of the most successful consumer CEOs in probably the last 20 years. And what's kind of funny about him, you would think that someone of that stature would be very hoity-toity, but he's actually a very simple guy. Having consulted for him and his teams, his favorite line was, "I'm a very simple man." And you knew that when you presented something and he said that to you, you're like, "Shoot, I missed the mark. I overcomplicated it and stuff." And I love his concept of, there are very few things that at the end of the day matter. Just focus on those things and then the rest of it just ignore. And it was just very freeing, I think, from that standpoint. So I'm just rereading it, ironically, going back to first principles.
And I think as leaders, we often overcomplicate things. And I think most of our podcast today has been about this idea of let's look at what you do and expand your category and really let's break it down to the nuts and bolts of what we can do to grow. And I think this complements the book very well. Now, you talked earlier about the superpower assessment. Of course, that's the free assessment on jakeacarlson.com/superpower. What was your leadership superpower?
Problem solving. So, which that made sense to me. That's what I've been doing for the last two decades and the like. So, but I really enjoyed the assessment, Jake. I love the book recommendations and some of the other content that came out of it. To your point about superconsumer, I'm a junkie for any Myers-Briggs, Enneagram. I love all of that stuff.
And so am I.
Yeah. So it's great. And it's frankly something that I've been doing with my children as well, just to avoid the assumption that they are like me or they are not like me, and or just realize they are their own people. And how do I more quickly figure out who they are? Because every time I learn something new, I'm like, well, that was obvious. Couldn't I figure that out earlier?
My teenage daughter just brought in the Myers-Briggs, her results, and we had a lot of fun just two nights ago talking through kind of who she is and what it means. And I love that kind of stuff. So great answer there. Our next question then is a motivational philosophy quote or mantra, something that you live by.
Yeah, no, it's something that's been on my mind. This is a quote by Ryu Suzuki. It's about the beginner's mind. He says, "In the beginner's mind, there are many possibilities, but in the expert's, there are few." And what I this is a quote that I got from a colleague of mine, Taddy Hall, who's a partner at Lippincott, a consulting firm and an expert on innovation. And what I love about this is it's just the reminder of, like, you know, I've built, in my profession, in my career, I have strived really hard to invest in expertise and thought leadership. And yet the part that I think keeps me young and keeps me curious and keeps me, frankly, closer to the cutting edge versus on the scrap heap is this idea that I am a beginner when it comes to understanding somebody else, when it comes to learning a new category, and that I would much rather live a life where I'm like, wow, there's so many different possibilities how to do X, Y, and Z. And that one of the hardest things that I deal with now in my work is when you come across somebody who genuinely is an expert on something, but they feel and believe themselves to be so, and therefore they're just kind of naysayers and say, well, I know this business X, Y, and Z, you know, inside and out. There's no way of doing what you're talking about. And that's why I love the idea, not is it true or can it be true or will it be true rather, but what needs to be true for X, Y, Z to happen? Like, it's such an important flip of mindset, because I get people to move from stop worrying about predicting if something's going to happen or not and just tell me, what would it look like if it actually came true? And then when you get to some really cool breakthroughs as a result of it.
Yeah, I love that question. All right, Eddie. Well, I appreciate you coming on the show. Before we let you go today, is there any last bit of advice? And then share with us how we can find out more about you, pick up a copy of Super Consumers, or read Joy by your daughter.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you can find me. I'm on Twitter at EddieWouldGrow. My website is EddieWouldGrow.com. And you know, you can find me on LinkedIn, of course, obviously all the social platforms, but, you know, and Amazon, you can buy both my book and Audrey's book. And I will tell you, buy Audrey's book, and that I love how your 8-year-old found it and has kind of claimed it for his own and stuff. Like, my hope is that one of the things that I think is, this is something that I'm digging into in my own life, is that behind workaholism, my hunch is that there's a level of, like, greed behind it. And one of the things that I remember listening to was someone saying, you know, greed is one of those vices that you just don't know if it's happening or not. Like, if you, you know, anger is obvious, you know, some of the other things that you can fall vice prey to. But greed is something, it's like the carbon monoxide. Like, you just don't know if it's happening to yourself. And my hope is that Audrey's book is just a little smoke alarm or carbon monoxide alarm to say, hey, where are you? You know, are you getting a little bit too consumed with your career? Are you about to lose your family? Can you take a pit stop and check out where you are in life? That's my hope. And so that's why I hope people will go get Audrey's book for that purpose.
Well, excellent. We'll link all of that up on the show notes for this episode. Eddie, this has been one of my favorite chats that we've had. I think that your background, your experience, and the way that you simplify and direct our attention towards this growth of categories is just, it's business changing. It's success changing for us, and we thank you for it. Thanks for coming on and being this week's Modern Leadership Guest Expert.
Thank you, Jake. It was my pleasure.
All right, my friends, and a big thank you to Eddie for coming on the show. Always great to talk to a leader who really has been in the trenches, and his experience, his background, what a great storyteller, and just some amazing nuggets of ideas throughout that entire episode. As we closed out the podcast, he was talking about greed a little bit, and it's something that's been on my mind. You know, this idea that there's this selfishness, there's this greed out there, and how it's impacting and halting our progression. And you know what we can do about it? I don't have a solution, but it's something that's been on my mind, something I've been thinking about. If you've got any ideas, go ahead and shoot me an email or jump on one of the social channels, Twitter, and let me know what you're thinking. Of course, everything that we talked about in this episode of the podcast can be found at jakeacarlson.com/ml. 136, episode 136. And until next week, I want to wish you the very best of days, an even better life, and of course, everything is figure outable. Thanks for listening to the Modern Leadership Podcast. You can find me on Facebook at Speaker Jake, on Twitter at Jake A. Carlson, and of course the website, jakeacarlson.com. See you there.